Balance is so hard in soccer because sometimes we view it as 50-50. Like, you can't attack and defend 50-50. You have to be prioritizing something. A reputation is people talking about what you are doing without you knowing about it. You're not going to solve every problem, and you're definitely not going to solve it how you want to solve it.
Hello, captains of Armband. Welcome to another episode of Short Corners, where we interview footballers, managers, coaches, analysts, scouts, directors, and owners of various football clubs to bring the different aspects of the game closer to you. Today, along with us, we have Mr. Gary Curneen, the assistant coach of Racing Louisville FC and the founder of Modern Soccer Coach. So Gary, how have you been?
I'm great, thank you. Thanks for having me on, and it's a privilege to come on your show.
Well, what are some future plans that you have for the Modern Soccer Coach?
Yeah, I've always said that the thing with the Modern Soccer Coach is that I don't really have any plans, that I don't really know what's going on. I just kind of, I use it almost as a creative outlet where I feel something and try things. I am planning, however, to do more like one day events rather than one-off webinars. So I think that's going to come in the pipeline for 2022. I'm knocking out a bit of content myself, you know, coming off the season. So I'm just sharing some sessions, some ideas, and putting some ebooks out. And then I have a couple of books out as well. I've got a book out that's almost detailing the journey that I've been on, plus lessons from the podcast. So just to try and I've been trying to make a more an active role in the last 3-4 months to put more on YouTube and put more on the website. So just to keep chipping away and keep committing to it, I enjoy putting it together. So it's a lot of fun.
First off, I want to ask you that you moved from Ireland to the USA at the age of 18 years, very young. Now, USA was a country that you've visited previously as a 14-year-old. So what were some of the early obstacles you faced and the lessons you learned after moving to a new country with a different culture?
Yeah, I think mentally, like, it was a big change at the time, but like, we all remember when we were 18 and then think, wow, like, I didn't worry as much about things, and I was more brave or courageous with decisions. Sometimes you'd think that you've got nothing to lose at that age. So I had planned for it for a few years with my family and had mentally prepared to come to the US, really wanted to come to the US. It was a dream to live in America. So when I came over, I thought that it would be skyscrapers in either Disney World or New York City, places I've been before. And it wasn't. It was difficult. It was really hard. Like, homesickness was hard. Moving somewhere to live is different from moving somewhere to go on vacation. I never thought of that at the time, but it was a big, big change. So I think I'm grateful for my parents for a lot of things, but probably the biggest thing I'm grateful for is the fact that during that really difficult time, they supported me rather than offering just an outlet. You know, if they had said, Gary, we've booked you a flight, come back tomorrow, I would have left. But they just kept buying phone cards and kept buying plans to call them every day, and so they could just keep me going. And once I made it 6 months, that was it. I was good. But when I look back now and the level of resilience that I had faced up to then, wasn't very high. Like, I didn't really experience a lot, and then that was probably the toughest thing. So going through that process changed me as a person, made me a better communicator. I had to go outside my comfort zone, so I developed a layer of confidence through it, and all these things that now I look back and I'm like, wow, that was amazing. But at the time, I found homesickness so difficult, almost like physical sickness. It was really, really hard, but I'm glad I went through it.
Well, as you said, family can be the biggest support that you can ever have. Mm. Now, coming to football, in the USA, you have coached for nearly 20 years now. And in one of your previous podcasts, you mentioned that as you went up the coaching ladder, you had to start focusing more on providing quality feedbacks rather than constant feedbacks. Now, how do you generally bring up the quality of your feedback during the training sessions and post-match analysis?
Yeah, probably more on the post side. Like, as a coach, I've in my journey, I now devalue more in training feedback. because like I don't have evidence. It's not evidence based. So, and that's just an opinion or a perception that's really buried in a lot of action and emotion. So I've started to learn that, you know, if it might look in my eyes that such and such hasn't done this in the middle of a training session, but that's just my perception. So what I try to do is have a little bit of empathy for what the player is experiencing and allow them to experience it, and allow them to enjoy the training. And then afterwards, the quality of the feedback, I think, is leveled in the visuals. Like showing someone a full video isn't really going to do it because they're going to disengage. I think showing someone a clip that's not really, like, they can look at one thing, I can look at another. So I use animations to be specific about what I want them to see. And then language, if I say that is wrong, and that's not right, then all of a sudden I'm creating a hierarchy of decision making, which might seem right at the time and it might be easier at the time. But if I want that player to take decisions on a Saturday and be independent with their performance, then I have to then be better with my language. So I have to say, listen, I thought this when you did this, what was your perspective? What was your decision? And allow them to almost disagree with you, I think, on things can develop a relationship. But I think at the older age groups especially, I think you have to start at the highest point, you have to start level with the player. Sometimes you have to start below them and say, listen, tell me what you were trying to do, and I'll try and get my head around this here and allow them to see that. But just the last part I would say then is consistency, is just to be like with some player, and it doesn't mean you have to do it every single day, but it's just chipping away at some players and allowing them, you know, there might be a 27, 28 year old World Cup winner. They might not need feedback. They don't need feedback every single day and every single game. But there's might be a 22-year-old who's just getting analysis for the first time, and that might just be once a week or something like that there. So I think quality is just checking in and constantly asking yourself if what you're delivering is right. And if you want to test it, look at the face of the player. And that's something I've learned as well, where probably 5 years ago I tested it by what I thought, and now I test it by what I see with what they're doing. So I put my hands up a lot of times and be like, I missed that. I missed that. I didn't get that right. It's a journey, and every player is different, as we all know. So it's just trying to take advantage of situations where you can get in front of them and show them some stuff.
And now continuing on this, some footballers do need feedbacks every now and then, as you said, and while some others rarely need them. How does this process of delivering feedbacks vary based on the characteristics of players, and also how does it influence the dressing room?
Yeah, it's a good question. I would say, you know, it's again, like, it's the old cliche, everyone's different, like you said, but it's trying to be empathetic, trying to have a level of humility to understand that it's almost a trial and error process for a coach early, and you're just trying to, you know, maybe you try and sit down with someone on an away trip with a laptop, and you gauge it, and you maybe you write that down and be like, if they weren't engaged in the conversation, I think sometimes as coaches, and I've done this, where we're a bit dismissive, where, well, such and such doesn't want to get better, or such and such doesn't like watching tape. But at the same time, like, I believe in my heart, every player wants to get better. So it's up to as a coach to find the key that works through that door. And that key might be a one-to-one sitting with a coffee. That key might be sending them something on WhatsApp, like a video made in WhatsApp, where you actually don't sit down and talk and allow them space with it. That one-to-one might be 5 minutes walking off the practice field. And I think something I learned a few years ago, a person called Donna Fischer, who does a lot of culture work in the USA. She's fantastic. And she complimented she came and observed me, but she complimented my formal coaching, which was presentations and all that glamorous stuff. But she said my informal coaching was awful. Like, I missed opportunities to talk to people. I missed opportunities to walk back. So these informal ways, that's how you learn how to connect to people. Something that I've tried to be better at. Like, and for some people, if you have a staff, I think, of 4 or 5 people deep, I think you can then say that, you know, such and such has a better understanding of that player, and maybe you layer that towards them like maybe you can connect with that there. But I think having the humility to say that, you know, as a coach, you're not going to solve every problem, and you're definitely not going to solve it how you want to solve it. You know, so you have to take a step back and say, right, well, I actually have to have a level of empathy towards what the player's seeing, and timing as well. Like, I think timing, we don't talk enough about coaches. We tend to just charge in at any time and coach people, but we don't understand that the other areas of the, you know, the game, post game can be a tough time for people because they might just switch off. Pre game can be a tough time for people because they might need their space. During the week, there might be stuff going on. So actually finding the right time to deliver your feedback and to be consistent with it, and to get them at a stage where they're ready to have a chat. And if they're ready, and if you get, I think if you get to the stage where they're ready to be really honest with you, and sometimes that honesty might mean, oh, I see it different. Brilliant. Now I've got more information into what you're thinking. Then I think that's the ultimate goal, I think.
That was very insightful, as I just learned a new term that is informal coaching right here. I did not hear this term before. So, you know, as during this podcast, we also get to know a lot of these things. And as football fans, you know, we don't really get to know how the inside works. So, you know, this is a great experience for me as a host as well. So continuing on, you once said coaching is not about proving your knowledge. It's about constantly improving your ability to deliver it. Now, recently in an interview, Thomas Tuchel talked about the importance of not overdoing things while managing an experienced group of players. Is there a way to find the balance between getting your ideas through to your players and also making sure that it's not limiting their abilities?
Yeah, I mean, another great question. And I think that's the aim, right? Because as coaches, and this sounds probably quite simple, but it's just positioning yourself in the old times is like position yourself at the top decision maker. You're doing everything, you're facilitating, picking the team, coaching everyone. You've got all the information. And I think coach education sometimes leads us down a road where we're getting so much information where we think that we are now 10 levels ahead of the player, and now we must educate everyone below us, almost like education of teachers. That's why they would get educated, to tear it down. But the difference, I think, with soccer coaching is that, you know, they don't need the principles of play. They don't need the collective. They need specifics on their world. So I think you need to then find ways to, yeah, get the balance right with what they need and also what they want. Like, some, again, like, I can't imagine going into a locker room where he's saying, like, Premier League players every single week, where you've got that amount of pressure, but also that amount of quality, and having to work around all the dynamics and get that. So I think you need people around you who are going to challenge, like, well, we need a bit more of this, or we need less of that. So I think having a good staff is important. And I also think then those relationships with the players, you know, it's not just about agreeing with you, because if the player comes in and says, yeah, that's great, yeah, that's great, well, then you tend to then feed off that and do more of it. So even if it's like, yeah, that's more information, and I think that's constant. That's not just a 2-week thing. That's something that, you know, again, we're, as coaches, we pride ourselves on detail, but at the same time, this is, like you said, that balance can be disengaging or boring people. And once you do that, with a game that's played with such a spirit, once you start disengaging people and they start doing this, that impacts how they play the game in 20 minutes. So I think constantly, and I would imagine those at the top, the top practitioners in the sport would be constantly asking, you know, is that, should it change a little bit of this, a little bit of that? And I think cooking is probably the best analogy of it, where it's like an ingredients, and it's not just, it's not just a binary, one or the other. It's a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And maybe you stir it this way, one way, or an ice cube there. You know, it's just, it's so complex and so many dynamics, but that's why we all enjoy it.
Well, obviously, managing is probably the most difficult job in football right now. And as you said, in such a league as the Premier League, it's like just pressure boiling over one mistake. And, like, you know, people are talking behind your backs that he's not good or he's not that great. And, you know, to highlight the difficulty of managing talented and independent decision makers, you know, you once said, or used The Last Dance as a reference. in one of the episodes of the series, while talking about Phil Jackson's prowess as a coach, Michael Jordan mentioned that no matter how good a player was, Phil had the ability to bring everyone together and make them play as a group. So how did you make that happen in a team and also hold them accountable for their actions?
Well, I've never got to the level of Phil Jackson, that's for sure. I mean, that's the holy grail out there is like such a high level. And again, when the skill set is that high, you know, the personalities are that much more difficult. And the pressure, like you say, is so high and intense as well. So I think whenever you're, when I look back now, and I'm an assistant now, and so when I look back and when I was a head coach and things were going well, I probably am coming now from a different angle to say, like, well, more of it might have been just a bit of fortune here, not luck in the game, but like luck with a player profile there and luck with maybe a bit of scheduling there and a result here or there. But I think the game is, you know, I think you do need a bit of momentum in this game. Definitely at the highest level, you need a little bit of momentum to get the results and to get the belief. And I think then you need the consistency of the everyday people coming in. And like you mentioned the word balance before, and it's balance is so hard in soccer because sometimes we view it as 50-50. Like you can't attack and defend 50-50. You have to be prioritizing something. But at the same time, it's almost a paradox where you need a comfort zone for people to come in every day and be happy and enjoy it. But then you also need an environment where they're not comfortable and they're challenging. And if you get that wrong, where people are coming in every day and they're annoyed, but yet they're comfortable in their soccer, then I view that's probably the biggest thing for me, where I look at an environment and I might have got it right, per se, where like I think that I got the environment, the feel of it right. Not necessarily the tactics or not necessarily the session design, because I feel like I've done that for different ways a lot of the time. The biggest difference that I've seen in teams that I got, that I think that I achieved that like Phil Jackson feeling was just the feeling around the place. And yeah, sometimes it's just a bit of momentum with a couple of wins, but sometimes you can get a few personalities and you can manage them right. But yeah, it's an amazing show, that Phil Jackson show. Like I've watched that probably about 5 times, that series, and it's just so many lessons of coaching. And sometimes we like this emotional intelligence and these cool words today, but he was doing that 30-40 years ago when he was on it, and it's still different level, so good.
Just coming back to football, is that let's take the Premier League for example. Now in recent years the Premier League has become like very busy, like for the players, even like game weeks, match in, match out, the maybe a Champions League in between, the teams playing in the Europa League, some teams even now with the new Conference League up. So it's probably games in every 3 or 4 days for the players. And with the Christmas period coming up, you know, it's going to get even more hectic. It's like probably one game in 2 days in that Christmas and New Year period. Pep Guardiola once mentioned that it's extremely difficult for the players, especially for the talented players, to be creative on, you know, every 2 or 3 days. What measures, if you were a coach, what measures would you take to help the players overcome their mental fatigue and keep them focused in such a busy period?
Yeah, good question. I mean, this might sound like a bit of a cop-out, that it would depend on how things are going. I think if you're, you know, fitness congestion is tough. It's tough to navigate around. And yeah, like mental fatigue is just as tough as physical fatigue. I think if you're winning and you're Pep Guardiola and you've got momentum going that way, then, you know, like you see it in Instagram and YouTube, you know, the City players doing some kind of a relay where they're keeping it up and they're putting it in the trash can and something like that. So it's keeping them, you know, probably ticking physical boxes and then probably keeping them active and keeping the second tier as close to the first tier physically so you can rotate the squad. Things like that there. So it's like it's probably lightening up the load but keeping emotion side high. But if you're going to trend in the other way in terms of results, you know, if you rock in and throw a relay race together, you know, you're probably going to have players who at best will accuse you of mixed messaging, like, or what's a relay race, like, I'm not going to have fun when I'm losing games. So maybe that you know, it would depend on the coach. Maybe that is actually, like, you see, you hear about it sometimes, and we look at it and coach it and go, oh, why would you do that? Why would you give them to Solskjaer? Got buried 3 weeks ago for giving the team 3 days off during a break. Why would you do that? Well, you would do that because the emotional fatigue is so much that if you need them to recover somehow. So maybe that's something, it's a brave decision. Maybe it's go and have a meal together. Maybe it's go and, you know, go to a movie or something like that there. So I would, you know, if I was in those shoes, it's a very, very difficult decision. You would hope that you're Pep and you can go out and put your cones out and have a laugh. But, you know, as luck would have it, you're probably going the other way. So, ultimately, like, you want to get that preparation right. And you've, you know, that preparation, you need the minds to be engaged and you need to want to be there. So I think that's the most important part is during fixture congestion. Fitness, you're not going to do it. A lot of the work is going to be through video based work and meetings. So just making sure that the environment is right for the people to sit in those meetings and actually want to be there, I think would be the most important thing.
Well, now coming to current times, you are now working as the assistant coach of Racing Louisville FC. The club recently hired a director of analytics. So how do you use those data to help you and your team and the individuals in the team improve?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's getting bigger part of the game, definitely in the last few years. You know, it's a forward-thinking club, so they want to be able to get the information right. And that's the data is used in, I would say, in every aspect, really. I think the data is used, data to per se is used in, you know, you've got the scientific data that we've had probably in the game for a few years now. Now you're looking at tactical data, so you're using that and then individual data with, like, technical data, I would say, maybe, if that's even a term. So you would look that in recruitment. So, you know, trying to get players that match the way you want to play. Then you would look at it in preparation for games, scouting. So what's the profile of the team you're up against and how do they shape up in the four moments? And, do you know, what's their tendencies given historical evidence on how they do this or how they do that? How do they defend set pieces? And then where you're trending with your game model, you know, and that tells you more about are you doing the things that your game model wants to be about? I think it's amazing. Like, it's been a really great learning curve for me because, again, going back to 10 years ago when I was working without both data, scientific, tactical, all this stuff, you're doing, you know, a lot of bias and a lot of guesswork. And sometimes as coaches, we've all done it where we watch a match or we coach a game and so much emotion and we come off the pitch and we proclaim to everyone that we played the beautiful game and the other team sat deep and they were lucky. And sometimes, you know, to get a review and to get a quantitative version of what happened, you might look and go, oh, what I experienced was one thing, but what actually happened was another. So I think bringing everyone together with facts and evidence and allowing that then to see trends, it's really, really enjoyable, really, really helpful, and it challenges every single person, I think, because you have that information you're getting is better, so feedback should be better, preparation should be better, so yeah, it's fantastic.
The regular National Women's Soccer League season has just ended. What were some of the key takeaways for the coaching staff, given the fact that the Racing Louisville had one of the youngest squads in the league?
Yeah, and the whole experience, like, from the preparation side and the infrastructure and frameworks, is something like I'm really passionate about. Is the analysis side and processes and kind of setting your work up, and then you've got your game model and probably going into it, I don't think I appreciated just the starting point. Like, the starting point with an expansion team is literally zero. Like, you don't have any relationships with any staff or players. You're starting from scratch all around. The players have never trained together. Your game model is zero. The history of the culture is zero. So you're starting from zero everywhere, and it's just constantly built. So it's a really, really intense environment, even without the match, you know, the accumulation of games, because you're doing everything, you're building things, and then you're riding this roller coaster of a season. So it's an unbelievable experience. Like, it's a really powerful experience. I think takeaways, like when you look back and you're looking at, well, you know, that's something that we're going through at the minute with reviews and trying to merge the experiences with, well, could we have done this better, or could we have done that better, or did we, were we aware of that there at the time? And I think that's something that, as you understand dynamics of teams, as you understand dynamics of people, we're all using our past experiences to deal with certain situations as coaches mostly. But then whenever you're putting it out live time, the people are different, so the results might be different. So I think it's just come out, there's so many lessons because you don't know anything. But it's fantastic. And and the players were absolutely brilliant every single day with attitudes, with the mindset. The club were so supportive as well. So yeah, it was a really, really good experience. Something that I felt that I got really, I got better every single week.
Well, as you said, it's very, very difficult to start from scratch. But one silver lining, I believe, is that the only way you can go is up. So let's hope the Louisville do even better the next time around. at the current stage of your life and career, how will you define success and failure in football?
Yeah, very deep question, that one. I think I've probably changed, but I changed a few years ago. Like, I looked at my career and where I was going, and I thought it looked as if I was trending in a direction that was kind of like, I went from a player to a grad assistant in America, then to a full-time assistant, head coach at Division 2, head coach at Division 1, assistant Division 1, head coach Division 1, assistant at the Pro League, and you're starting to do this here and there. But then I didn't start a question where if I was just following something, a traditional pathway, or if it was something that I really wanted to do. So now I say I would chase experiences and more like happiness. Like, I want to be, fulfillment is something that I want to be, like, I want to be involved. I want to be going every day and actually solve problems that I want to solve and be involved in helping things that I'm passionate about, rather than, you know, I think sometimes in soccer you can, you know, I think it's okay for a coach to say they don't want to be Pep Guardiola, you know, like they enjoy working with 6-year-olds and 8-year-olds, or they enjoy being an analyst, and they, you know, you don't have to, just because Jose went from this to this doesn't mean everyone has to do it. And that's something that, you know, again, I'm getting older, so I'm obviously changing, and my family's a big, big part. So you want to be like, I've been a head coach where, you know, I've come back to my family and I'm there physically, but I'm not there mentally, and I'm not there emotionally. I knew that, you know, around that time, I'm like, this shouldn't be it, you know? And so I start to think about that there, and that scares me a lot. So I want to make sure that when I'm doing my work, that I'm happy, and when I'm at home and I'm happy and I feel like I'm contributing to things. So that's how I view success. I don't view it through, again, getting to a level. I don't view it from number of trophies. I view it in the richness of your experience. If you're enjoying something, if you're enjoying who you're being around, if you're there mentally, emotionally with people, I think that's success. And I think today, with so much pressure and so much noise externally around us, I think as coaches we should be more, you know, we love this, like, mental health day one day a year, and we all tweet something, but we don't really talk about, like, happiness. And I think, you know, and that's on me too, like, I should do a bit more of this, but I think it's fine to say, you know, like, I coach an under 11 team one day a week, and I have fun and I enjoy it, and I don't want to be sitting in Manchester United dugout next week. I'd rather watch them play on TV, and that's okay, that's fine. And that's something that maybe if we were a bit more upfront about that there as coaches, then we would enjoy it a bit more, you know. But I think sometimes I look at coaching and I see that people are busy, people are working really, really hard, people are getting information and knowledge, but are people enjoying it? And it's hard to enjoy it if you're in the Man United dugout. I'll put my hands up there, and it's hard to enjoy some environments, but But for a lot of environments, the game's the game. You know, we should be chasing that there instead of state titles or anything, you know, glamorous. That's just my opinion. But again, I'm getting a bit older, so I might be changing.
No, it's absolutely all right. You know, at the end of the day, it's about how you live your life, how you're in control of your life and what you want out of life itself. Like if it's happiness, then it's good. If it's titles, it's, you know, someone else's, you know, drive to get there. Let's just come back a bit to Racing Louisville. Ebony Salmon's move to Louisville from Bristol City garnered a lot of attention. How would you assess the English player's development as she finished the season as the team's leading goal scorer?
Fantastic. Yeah, I mean, she's so exciting to watch, and she's even more exciting to work with on a daily basis. Fantastic attitude, mindset, work ethic, and then also this talent that's, like, she's so the first game she came off the bench and scored the winner within 5 minutes, but it's this, like, this talent slash mentality to score goals. She loves scoring goals, and she has the ability to turn a game on its head, and she's so young. And you're right, like, it's when you're looking at us, I think that's what garners all the attention. Is usually players in the league, there's a transition period. With the NWSL is a really, really tough league. The average age is going up and up, so it's challenging for the young players to come in and make impacts right away. And Ebony has done that, and again is also broke into the national team as well. And when you're watching on a daily basis, again, it was the first question you asked me about going away from home. And you know, when you're looking at sometimes social media and you watch these young players breaking through at higher levels, you don't appreciate that they're coming to a different country, they're leaving their family. Yeah, you've got the current pandemic situation where they're not seeing their family a lot and things like that there. So she's working through that there, and she comes in every day with a smile on her face and loves the game and loves the work. And yeah, I've really enjoyed working with her. I can't wait to see what happens next.
And finally, Gary, what are some of the things an aspiring modern-day football coach must keep in mind? What's your advice?
My advice would be, like, again, I think there's two parts to coaching, and there's the knowledge that we're all trying to get. And again, get the knowledge, like, dig deep in that knowledge, read every single book you can get, watch every webinar, listen to interviews. There's so much out there today. Use social media for its benefit rather than just opinions. Like, get that information and go after it. But also the most important thing that I would say is then alongside that is get out in the grass and work and enjoy it. But also then when you do that, that will, you know, I've mentioned the word humility a few times, like, and it's not to say that I was brought up as this humble person. Like, my humility, I believe, comes from the fact that the game has humbled me so many times and still does, where you think you've got something worked out and you go and do it and it goes horribly wrong. And rather than blame the players because you got the exercise from Pep, look at yourself and say, are they ready for it? Did I set it up right? Was, you know, all these questions, but always put it back. Take the hits. You don't have to take the hits publicly, but take the hits internally, and that will build a level of humility, I think. And that level of humility, again, if you want to work at higher levels, I think going in somewhere and having a level of humility where you don't know it all, but you're willing to communicate with people and you're willing to give people the benefit of the doubt. Again, I think as coaches, there is a little bit of a culture where, again, I think it's because of social media. It's easy to jump on a tweet and say, I did everything today. The players weren't, you know, I don't have the right players, or I don't have this building, or I don't have this technology. And if I had all this, I would be brilliant. Nah, you wouldn't. Like, you'd still probably make a lot of mistakes like the rest of us. So it's just being open-minded, not just to things within the game, but also being open-minded to be that even when you have everything and even when you set it up, you know, we're not in as much control of this game as we think we are. So that goes back to enjoy what you're doing, be enthusiastic every day. And back to that under 11 example, if you're working with, I think a lot of young coaches today want to do their courses, get a license and work at Manchester United. But in reality, like, that's not going to happen. You, in order to develop, and if you, like you mentioned before there, like maybe someone does want to win titles and progress their career, if that's what you want to do, someone will have to give you jobs at all those places. So you will have to develop a reputation, and a reputation is not going online and posting your wins. A reputation is people talking about what you are doing without you knowing about it. So I would say to be really aware of that there by doing, you know, always being enthusiastic, always making sure people have a good experience. If for some reason you and your vision of what you're doing doesn't align with the player, you know, be compassionate with the player on that there and be like, hey, listen, you know, this is, you don't have to fall out with people. You know, it's not Sky Sports where there's going to be a transfer deadline and all that there. Like, it's life. Just enjoy and get a reputation for being dependable, being enthusiastic, being quality in your work, and always bringing something to the table. I think once you do that, then you set yourself up to where doors will open. People will gravitate towards you because of your personality, and all of a sudden things can happen. But I think sometimes as coaches, where we are outcome focused in terms of the results, we can also be outcome focused in terms of careers, and we need to be careful for that.
A quick shout out to our merchandise partner, Midfield Merchandise. If you want to buy quality 100% cotton t-shirts, stickers and lapel pins at affordable prices, Midfield Merchandise is the place to visit. Upon applying this coupon code, you will get a special 30% discount on your purchases. The link to the site and the coupon code are also given in the description below. Yeah, that was very well put by you, Gary. And I think that is mostly the reason that we love this beautiful game, right? It's so unpredictable, but yet it can be very challenging at times as well. So, captains, that was all for today. We need to end our session here. Thank you, Gary, for being with us today.
No, thank you so much. Thank you.
To all of our viewers, thank you a lot for tuning in. You can support us on Patreon. The link to our page is given in the description. Until next time, it's goodbye from Armband.